around 100 people. This science communication workshop has been planned since a few months back, and this we would like to organize, thought of organizing on the Amrit Mahotsav. Now it has been finalized, and we have a good resource persons, Dr. Dinesh Sharma sir and Ms. Sneha Varghese. Both are very like have a very good knowledge in this science communication. One is senior veteran, other one is a person who is with a science background and mass communication and journalism PhD. So this workshop, I'm confident and I'm hopeful that this will be very much useful for all of those who are investing 3 hours in this workshop. I understand joining online, attending meetings online is a tiresome, but please bear with us, and I hope it will be an enjoyable and interactive one. So to formally welcome you all, Dr. BNS Murthy sir, Director ICRIHR, Dr. Venkat Kumar, HOD, Social Sciences and Training, Dr. M.V. Dhananjaya, Secretary, Society for Promotion of Horticulture, and also Principal Scientist at ICRIHR. My colleague, Atikula, Scientist in Extension Division. And myself, I warmly welcome you all for this workshop. Science needs to be communicated and it should be open. Recently, the UNESCO also adopted the Open Science Policy, and the member states are obligatory to follow it, and science should be always communicated and science should be open. With this, I leave the floor to the you all, and the speakers will be taking care. So before that, may I request Dr. Venkat Kumar sir to kindly give his remarks, a few remarks before the start of this program. Dr. Venkat Kumar, sir.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Sridhar. Very good morning to all of you. Respected Director, Indian Institute of Horticulture Research, Dr. BNS Murthy, sir. Dr. M.V. Dhananjay, Secretary, Society for Promotion of Horticulture. Dr. Sridhar Gootam and Mr. Atikula, organizers of this program. Speakers, Dr. Dinesh Sharma and Ms. Sneha, and all the participants who joined this program online. Very good morning to all of you. This is a program which was proposed by Dr. Sridhar Gootam, and he approached us the Division of Social Sciences and Training. We would like to have this program, and we readily agreed, and we agreed to have a collaboration and have this program in association with the Society for Promotion of Horticulture. Actually, the basis of the program is like this. Any common man, public, he will take the decision based on the evidence, research evidence. So the research results, empirical results, has to be communicated to the public and common man. For this, the science communication is very important. When it comes to agriculture, the common man or the stakeholder is farmer, and along with that, we have the extension personnel and policy makers. So the results of empirical results of agriculture has to be communicated to the public of the agriculture, that is the farmer and the other policy makers and all. So that way, this science communication workshop is very, very important one. For this, I would like to thank Dr. Sridhar for his efforts and all. So when it comes to the science communication, according to the popular expert of communication, Dr. Paul Ligons, the success of communication is depending upon the audience response. That is how the audience give the feedback and how they respond to the communication is very important. According to the science communication of agriculture is concerned, we are having the audience farmers, and for this particular workshop, we are having the audience as the researchers, students, and the other participants of this program. So their response would be positive for this program. So when we talk about science communication in this platform, we are having the channels of research journals, popular journals, mass media, as well as social media. And we have to treat the message, we have to tell the audience of these participants to treat the message according to the channels, that is research journals, popular journals, social media, and mass media. And I hope that Dr. Dinesh and Madam Sneha will sensitize and orient the participants towards treating the messages according to the channels, whatever we have in front of us for science communication of agriculture. Once again, I would like to appreciate the efforts of Dr. Sridhar Gootam for making efforts to organize this program. And I also would like to thank Mr. Atik Lata, the volunteer, for coordinating this program along with Dr. Gootam. I would like to thank our Honorable Director, Dr. B.N.S. Murthy sir, for giving us this opportunity to have such workshop. And also I would like to thank the Secretary of Society for Promotion of Horticulture, Dr. M.E. Dhananjay, for co-sponsoring this program along with Indian Institute of Horticulture Research. Once again, I welcome all who joined this platform for this wonderful workshop. Thank you, Ananda. Now the floor is for the speakers. Dr. Sridhar.
Sir, before that, we may have the remarks from the Secretary SPH, Dr. Dhananjay, sir.
Sridhar, you can switch on your camera also. Your camera is off.
So, good morning, everyone. I'm Dr. Dhananjay MV, Principal Scientist working in the Division of Vegetable Crops, presently taking care of Society for Promotion of Horticulture. Respected Director, distinguished resource persons of this wonderful program initiated by Dr. Sridhar Gootam for the cause of science, for a better communication to the targeted, especially farmers, because we all agriculture scientists mainly, our target group is farmers, how best we can communicate with the farming community. With that intention in mind, this also the researchers and teachers, students who are going to involve in this kind of job, how effectively they will be able to communicate or connect with the farming community is the main motto of this program. So I also there are 110 participants for this great program. As Society for Promotion of Horticulture General Secretary, I would like to bring to the knowledge of all the participants the salient activities that the society has undertaken for the cause of science and development in horticulture sector. We have around 1,100 life members. Our society, from its inception 2006, we have around 1,100 members, life members, with almost 28 patrons who are really, have the blessings on this growth and development of the society. We have the whole, our society, all the process of publications, it is open access, and all online processing is we have already initiated from the past 2 years. Our society has come out with a journal, Journal of Horticultural Sciences. Due to our continuous efforts, the predecessors and all the other previous people, our society's journals NOS rating has gone up tremendously from almost 3.58 to 5.08 in the recently published NOS rating. And we are working towards further improving the ratings and impact factor. We are trying for getting UGC recognition. We are also in the process of, Thomson Reuters recognition, so that our NOS ratings will go beyond 6 shortly. Already our journal is under observations from the concerned Thomson Reuters people. We are expecting that we will be getting, because we are trying our best to increase our quality of our publications in our journal. So these are some of the things. And also I would like to share, every year we have constituted some awards, some fellows, and very recently we have initiated a student travel grant for 2 outstanding PhD students for their presentations in international conferences. We have also initiated to encourage in-service faculty and teachers, researchers, associate fellow. So like this, many initiatives we have undertaken for the cause of science. Also we have active collaboration with International Society for Horticultural Sciences. Many horticulture universities, other societies inside the country also, we come forward and join hands whomsoever is interested to organize events like this, also seminar, symposium, workshop for the cause of science. So we provide them seed money to initiate such programs in collaboration with Society for Promotion of Horticulture. So we are for the cause of growth and development of the horticulture sector through contribution through science. And also, so one of the important contribution of our society is that we have donated around 70 lakhs worth infrastructure to our host institution, Indian Council of Agriculture Research, IIHR. Around 70 lakhs worth infrastructure we donated for organizing National Horticulture Fair and so many seminar symposium whenever they need. So such is the contribution that this society has made to the cause of science with the support of all the 1100 plus members. So I take this opportunity to all the participants who have joined this very good initiative by Dr. Sridhar Guttam to be part of this society, so that this society can grow further and further for the cause of horticulture science and development. Just for the information of all the participants, we have two upcoming events. We have with the association with the World Vegetable Centers IIHR, Asian Solanaceous Roundtable, we are having in the month of coming May 2022. I request all of you, please note the date and join the wonderful program. The last year success has made them to once again continue with association with our society and institution. So with this few, brief remarks, I thank all the participants for showing interest in registering and joining this wonderful program. We have made this with the help of our IIHR and Dr. Guttam and society. Thank you, Ananda, for giving me an opportunity.
Thank you, Dr. Dhananjay, sir, for your remarks and then introducing the society and its activities to the participants. Not too much delay, the business now coming. We have Dr. Dinesh Sharma, sir, who is, I think many people might have seen the Vignan Prasars, the India Science Wire. He is the founder, managing editor of that initiative. Because of that, I think much of our technologies of the sponsored technologies from the DST and other institutions are on the website, and it's now like being read and watched and then followed by many of these. So I will be requesting sir to speak. So before that, I would like to introduce him for the benefit of the other audience. Dr. C. Sharma is an award-winning journalist, author, media trainer with over 35 years of experience of reporting on science and technology, health and environment for national and international media outlets. He has authored 3 major books and is an invited speaker at national and international universities and research institutes. His book on the Indian IT industry, The Outsourcer, was published by MIT Press in 2015. The book was awarded the prestigious Computer History Museum Book Prize instituted by the American Society for History of Technology. Another book on 100 innovations that have transformed India in the past 75 years is slated for launch in 2022. Sir, we'll all will be waiting for this book to launch, and we would like to have this treasure in with us. At present, he is the Jawaharlal Nehru Fellow researching on the evolution of Hyderabad as a technology cluster. The Hyderabad, how it has evolved as a technology cluster is much of an important. So I, being from Hyderabad, would like to know more on that. To add more, Dr. Sharma has been the science editor at Mail Today, which is a part of the India Today group, from 2007 to 2014, and founding manager editor at India Science Wire from 2017 to 2019. He has taught a course in development journalism for MA students at Ateneo de Manila University, and been a teaching fellow at the Jawaharlal Nehru University. This is her is the brief introduction to of Dr. Sharma sir. Dr. Sharma sir, the screen is yours. Sir, muted.
Yeah. Thank you, Dr. Sridhar, for those kind words and for inviting me for this interesting science communication workshop. It's been my, you know, fortune that I have been involved in science communication and talking to scientists and researchers in various capacities, including training for the AUSAR program, which DST runs, which some of you would have heard and participated. So it's always good to connect with a group of people who are interested in science communication, and that too online, because everybody is now gone into fatigue of online, but still I can see the large number of participants who have joined. And I must congratulate the organizers, Dr. Gautam, Dr. Gautam, Society for Promotion of Horticulture and IIHR, for taking this initiative, because while we should talk about science communication, I think today, these days are the most relevant period when we are going through a pandemic for the past 2 years, and now we're going to enter the third year. And that has brought to the fore the importance of science communication, because everybody has realized how important it is to talk about science, how important it is to talk about the method of science, how science works. I mean, there's been a lot of discussion on how vaccines are made, how white vaccines are important, how they generate immunity, what is herd immunity. There's been a lot of discussion in these subjects in the past 2 years. So science communication, I think, is very relevant, and it's very critical for, as we know, because you're all from the background of agriculture research. So you know that how important communication of research is for taking your results to the people. And Dr. Venkatram has talked briefly about why you want to communicate agriculture science. And he said that the key stakeholders are farmers and policymakers. So here I would like to add that the society and the general public are also a key stakeholder in this whole, you know, arena of agriculture science communication. So you have to look at, because he also mentioned that communication is important from the point of view of whom you are communicating. See, all of you are good communicators, I would say. Every scientist is a communicator. But what is the difference? See, you write research papers, which is a form of communication. It was mentioned that, you know, various journals are there and a lot of new research is published in journals. So that is one form of communication. Then you deliver lectures, you go and talk to people. That is also a form of communication. Some of you also, you may be writing for newspapers and, you know, or appearing on television. So that's another form of communication. But I want you to differentiate in all these three or four forms of communication. When you're writing a research paper, you're talking to your own community. You know your audience very well. When I write for a journal of agriculture or horticulture, or even a medical journal, I know who is my audience. I know that people who are going to read those papers will have a certain level of understanding of the subject. So I have the liberty to use the scientific jargon, so to say. So your audience is defined when you're talking, when you're writing a research paper. So that that kind of communication will be different. When you go and talk to farmers, again, you know that the audience is different in the sense it is defined. You know a farmers coming from a particular region, a particular agroclimatic zone, what are they growing, you know the soil type, and you know different, you know, you have a broad idea of their socioeconomic background. So again, your audience is well defined. You know when you're going to talk to farmers for your extension work. But when you're talking to general public, when you're giving a talk in a school, or when you're going to give a radio talk, or when you're writing an article, that audience is not defined in a way you define your audience for your research papers. Because in that audience, there may be people who know about science, there may be people who know about agriculture, there may not be people who don't know anything about method of science and things like that. So the communication when you want to do with the communicate your ideas, your research, your science to general public, it calls for a different kind of approach. And some of those things we are going to touch upon this, you know, workshop today, and I'm sure Sneha will take care of that. So, but I want you to appreciate that, you know, when you're communicating to scientists, when you're communicating to farmers, and when you're communicating to general public, there are three different kinds of communication you have to. And every time you have to have a different communication strategy. So please bear that in mind. And I mean, in a 3-4 hour workshop, we cannot tell you everything about communication or how to go about, but I want you to appreciate these things, because most often, even topmost senior scientists do this mistake of not differentiating between the two. The presentation which they make for a scientific conference, the same presentation they'll make for a general public or in a front of school kids. It doesn't make sense. You know, the people don't get to know. Suppose you're an agriculture scientist. I'm also a scientist, but in a different field. So for me, when you're talking of agriculture, I'm a lay person. But here you're talking of general public whose level of understanding may not be that high. So you cannot use the same presentation. You cannot use the same jargon. You cannot use the same language when you talk to general public. So please bear that in mind. So therefore, I think science communication is very important. And 1 or 2 minutes I'll spend on agriculture communication per se. There was a talk, there was a mention about extension. See, it's a very important to remember that how we have come to this stage of agriculture research where we are today. From being a country which was dependent on imports, you are now a country where we are not only self-sufficient, but we are also exporting a number of agriculture commodities. So all that change was brought about by, we all know about the Green Revolution. I don't need to tell agriculture scientists about that. But I want you to remember what role extension played in that. That was a very, you know, key input into the success of agriculture. Because if you imagine the kind of farming we had, it was 200-year-old farming, there was hardly any use of chemicals. So what you needed to communicate to farmers was not just a new variety, but a new way of farming. And that was achieved with extension and communication. And that is when the special strategies of communication were evolved. That how do you communicate? How do you want farmers to appreciate that, you know, use of chemicals is important, how much of it is important, use of irrigation, all those are new concepts. So what agriculture communication and extension at that time did was to, you know, look for a behavior change. The communication at that time, the extension work was designed for behavior change of communication, behavior change of farming. We had to move farmers away from their age-old practices to a new system. And that's where, you know, extension became very critical. And since then, it has been part of our agriculture research, and it's a specialized branch of communication. And I'm not an expert on that, but I'm sure you will be talking about that. So extension is a specialized branch, which needs a special kind of, you know, skills. But at that time, the mass media played a very important role in agriculture extension. I don't know if anybody would remember, there's something called radio varieties. So the new varieties of rice and wheat which were propagated, they were propagated through radio communication, through special talks, special programs on radio. And some of those varieties became so popular that they came to be known as radio varieties. You know, farmers would remember them as radio varieties. So that's the power of communication. And it was around the same time this very famous program called Krishi Darshan was evolved. You know, it was the scientists who made this program. It was a space scientist. It was designed and conceived by Dr. Sarabhai because he wanted to use space technology for communicating ideas for rural development, for new, you know, ideas to be communicated to farmers. So he thought that social scientists, communicators, scientists and space technology should come together and have this kind of a program. And it was an experiment that can television be used to communicate ideas. So that's how Krishi Darshan was evolved. So there is a history of agriculture communication, and that's a rich history. And of course, now we have moved from radio and television and print to social media and the new challenges. I'll talk about that. So I don't think I should talk about why we need to communicate science. Of course, because I believe that a lot of our knowledge is locked in our institutions. As I said, the scientists always believe in writing more papers, talking to their own community, talking to, you know, scientists among themselves. But how much of it, that knowledge which is locked in our institutions, is getting out to people who are not scientists? Dr. Sridhar runs this open source. He has a lot of interest, and you also mentioned about open source. So how much of this science, the scientific and technical knowledge, can it be translated in a language which people can understand, so that we are unlocking the knowledge? So that's for the science communication. The role of science communicators is that you know, some of this knowledge which is locked in our research papers, research institutes, and that's what we need to communicate. So that's how the science news is created. What is science news? It is mostly based on the research papers which come out. Science journalists like us talk to scientists, try to explain, get the importance of the findings, and communicate that to the general public. See, the general public may not be a stakeholder for agriculture research directly, but it is important to communicate ideas of science to general public, that how does science work? How does method of science work? You know, what is a clinical trial? How does a vaccine work? So those are also the ideas which, so that there is a greater appreciation of science in the general public. It is not that I can use every information in my farm or I can grow something, but I should be able to appreciate. So therefore I said your stakeholder should not only be the farmers and policymakers, but also the general public, because there should be a general appreciation for science in the society. And that's how, you know, scientists are able to get support, and that's therefore they should indulge in science communication also. That's one immediate gain, I would say, because there are a lot of anti-science tendencies in the West. Fortunately, we don't have that much here. So we need to counter all that. So therefore, appreciation of science, how science works, how, you know, research is done, all that needs to be appreciated by general public. And it also inspires more people to join the science stream. You know, when you go and deliver a talk about agriculture research or medical research or any scientific research to a group of students, you're also motivating them to take up science, take up research, and get interested in that. Therefore, in general, the science communication is very important. Then also one question which I'm very often asked is, what do we communicate? And how do we communicate? So I'll take this question of scientists always face, what do we communicate? We are working in a very highly specialized area. You know, how can we communicate this to people? I'm working on one particular method. I'm working on, say, gene editing. I'm working on, you know, a new variety or whatever could be your area of research. So how do we, you know, what should we communicate? Should we tell what exactly we are doing in our lab, or, you know, is it something else? So that the answer to this question is very simple. You need to communicate. Of course, you start with your own research, that, you know, what you're doing, you want to communicate, and that's that's the primary target of your you know, communication should be, that what you're doing, is it something which you can explain to people in general public or not? If it is possible, you do that. If not possible, you look at a slightly larger area. Suppose you're working in a field of horticulture. There are a number of issues. There are a number of ideas in horticulture, or even, you know, veterinary science, or any of your research, the areas you pick up. There are number of areas which connect to the society directly or indirectly. So you have to identify those things, you know, and try and explain those ideas to people. Especially because agriculture is such a field that you're dealing with food, you're dealing with nutrition, you're dealing with diet, you're dealing with air quality, you're dealing with environment, you're dealing with climate change. So there are a number of subjects, you know, which connect directly with the society. So you start with your own area of particular research, then look at the larger, you know, area around that, and then you identify certain topics which you feel which can be communicated to people. So it's not very difficult. I always tell that PhD students that can you write a summary of your PhD in a language which a non-scientist, a non-specialist can understand. So that's the beginning point. See, many of the journals now insist that, you know, you write a layman summary. So it is meant that you communicate science to the society, to the policy, because after all, what are policymakers? They're part of society. So when you are talking of society, you are including all the key stakeholders in that. So when you if you are able to write layman summary of your research, like many funding agencies also these days insist, that what is the significance of your research to the society? So in fact, what that does is to make you think. Otherwise, you're always thinking narrowly in your own stream. You know, I have to do this research, I have to publish this paper, I have to get this award, to get this promotion. So we have a track. I'm not saying all those things are not important, but you have to connect your work to the society. Therefore, these, you know, journals are insisting that you write a layman summary or, you know, the funding agencies insist that. So if you can do that, that's the part you need to communicate to the society. And in today's context, then I'll come to how do you communicate. I've told you how to identify subjects. You start looking around your own research paper, your own PhD, your own institute, your own council, then you go beyond. So that itself is a large area. So you can identify subjects out of that, and then how do you communicate? I mean, I can't get into the techniques of writing and all, which I'm sure Sneha will elaborate on those issues, because it's better done face to face, but somehow we can at least introduce some of those ideas to you. And of course, you can also do a lot of self-learning. There are a number of courses on how to write, how to communicate, but I'll just give you a broad view of how do you go about it. See, there are a lot of misconceptions about every area these days. You know, there's a lot of very important area that has emerged is something called fake news. There are a lot of misinformation, miscommunication, and fake news on various subjects, and particularly agriculture. For example, I'll just take this whole issue of organic food. I mean, it has become a fad. But how do you tell people what is organic and what is not organic? It becomes a problem. You know, if I tell somebody that the plant which you grow in your own balcony can still contain contaminant, people will not believe. Because they'll say it's a pure tulsi, neem, this, that, which is growing in our own compound, in my own balcony. How can it have, you know, anything toxic? But they are not looking at simple thing that from where are you getting your soil? Soil may be contaminated. It may contain, you know, all the heavy metals, and those get ingested into the plant, and which are ingesting yourself by eating. So these are the simple things which you need to bust. So the job of a science communicator in today's context, when fake news is very, you know, it's being distributed and people are believing a lot of fake news, misinformation, it's your job of a science communicator is also to best these kind of things. Then what about pesticides? There are various things about pesticide residue and how much of it is good or how much of it is permissible, and there are a lot of misconceptions. So there are number of issues which directly connect to the people. So using science, using evidence, you can address some of these issues. So number one is communicate your own research, then you can also try to clear misconceptions of people. And how do you do that? Do you always start with Times of India and Hindu and CNN and things like that, or where do you begin? That's another question which people ask, that how do we communicate science to the public? I mean, the moment you say communication to the public, people think of big newspapers and big television and All India Radio and all that. But that's not so, fortunately. That was the case, say, a few years back. Now you have various avenues of communicating science. For example, this workshop, so many people have joined online. Everybody is using social media. Everybody, I think almost everybody on this in this meeting would be on Facebook. And we keep sharing things on Facebook. So identify a subject and start communicating your ideas briefly through social media, I would say. That's even before you write a full article, if you can articulate your idea in, say, 100 words, communicate that. Write some small post on organic food. Write a small post on pesticides, write a small post on climate change, according to your area of interest, your area of specialization, and communicate. Because at least you are able to bust something, at least you are able to counter a few misconceptions in the people. So that's the beginning point. See, science communication also is about promoting rationality. It's also about giving people a rational way of thinking. You ask people to think that if you're saying that organic food grown in my balcony is good, why do you think so? Question them, have a debate. So that kind of a thing. I'm saying these are things which are around you, which are in your friend circle, which are in your social circle. So you start with that, and then you start building up, then you write a blog post, then maybe you can create a podcast. There are a number of ways, because the technology has become easily accessible. The entry barriers are very low. So you can create your own YouTube channel and start building. So don't wait that if somebody invites me, then I'll write an article for them or I'll appear on television. You can have your own channels and start communicating. And then it will start building up. So along with your research papers and along with your scientific conferences, you start building a parallel channels like this and start communicating, then you will also be able to get a lot of feedback. See, suppose I write in Times of India or I appear on a television channel, how much feedback I get? Very little. I don't know whether people are liking it or not. Whereas on social media, you're able to have a two-way communication. Then also you can gauge how much people are able to, digest that information. Do they understand that? So that kind of thing. So start building your portfolio, your ideas, and start communicating them in a small way. So those are the basic thoughts which I wanted to leave you with. And it's a vast field. As I said, there are a lot of online courses on science communication, on agriculture communication, which you can go through, and depending on your interest and time, maybe societies like your SPH and IHR can organize workshops where people come and sit and do actual writing, speaking, and do those things. Because I have run residential courses at ISRs in the past, which are 15-day courses, and some of I think a couple of people might have attended that in this. So where we actually teach how do you write, how do you get into different media and things like that. So it needs a lot more training, it needs a lot more interest and time. So I'm sure some of you would be interested in those kind of things, and all of you as agriculture scientists are involved in communication in one way, but I want you to appreciate that communication has to be targeted at different audiences. And what I have spoken to you about is how do you try to reach non-specialists, the general public, and the society. So I'll stop at this, and I'm sure the how part, especially, Sneha can deal with it in her presentations. Thank you.
Sir, thank you very much for giving how the evolution of agriculture extension communication started with the necessity of communicating the to the masses about the new for the behavioral change, and then now you have ended at like how we don't need to look for some big agencies, but we ourselves can be a science communicator through social media, putting the stop the fake news. Sir, this I'm sure that many of the attendees and like I also got much knowledge from your talk, and maybe sometime in the life we would like to have you as in person training us on this kind of communication when this pandemic ends. So having said that, now can Dr. Atikula, can we
move to I just next? Want to add that I'll share a link of one of my interviews where I have spoken about all the frequently asked questions on science communication. So participants can look at that. It's a longer interview. I'll share the link in the box.
Yes. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you very much for your time, and we are very much thankful to you, sir. Thanks, Sneha, for bringing sir onto this meeting. Thank you. Atik.
Thank you, sir. A song is not a song until it is sung. A knowledge is not a knowledge until it's shared in proper scientific format. With this, I would like to begin the introduction of one of the resource speaker of today's function. Registration so far we have crossed 323 registration. That itself is a testimony of the importance of this topic. Recent past, we have 153 members logged in online. It's one of the biggest number in the webinars we could see. That itself is a showing the importance and relevance of this program. Now I would like to share the brief profile of resource person, Ms. Neha Vagis. She is a double postgraduate in biotechnology. You may be amazed how this come. A social media and this thing, double biotechnology. Yes, it's she has done that. And she has mass communication and journalism from Osmania University and is currently awaiting to become PhD in mass communication. She was a university gold medalist in her master's program in journalism and has qualified JRF-19, both journalism and biotechnology. She has also been a member of Board of Studies for Biotechnology and English at Osmania University College for Women, COTI. Sneha is currently working in ICR, Central Research Institute on Rail and Agriculture, which is located in Hyderabad as assistant. She's been a part of ICR since 2017. She has several research credits to her portfolio. She has also done lots of news stories, featured articles in various newspapers to her credit. Was also an associate editor for the book COVID Chronicles, brought out by Osmania University in the recent times. She has also worked as Yuvani announcer for All India Radio. She was also a freelance science writer and weekly columnist for Hans India newspaper for more than 3 years. She also writing a column titled Nature Narratives, using fiction to explain science to children and young adults. And she has also published nearly 150 articles till date. She has more than 5 years of overall teaching experience and has been a guest faculty for science communication at the National Institute of Nutrition and Osmania University for PG students, and also for J-Hub, which provided training to aspiring journalists. This is only in brief of the portfolio of Ms. Neha Vagis. Ma'am, I'm a bit envious of you. In such a short time, you have so much credentials to yourself. As Sridhar sir told, we would like to have Sharma sir and yourself as trainees offline at IHR in the normal times. With this background, I leave the session to Ms. Neha Vagis to take over. Please, ma'am.
Ma'am, please, 1 minute. We have Director Dr. B.N.S. Murthy, sir, who's just joined. He's in another meeting till now. So, can we have your remarks, sir, please?
No. Before my remarks, I want to hear her. Just afterwards, I will be with you.
Okay, sir. Then, Sneha, this screen is yours.
Thank you so much, Dr. Atikula. First of all, it's a great pleasure to be here on this platform, to be a part of this webinar organized by ICR IHR. I thank Dr. BNS Murthy, sir, director IIHR, and also Dr. Venkat Kumar and Dr. Dhananjay, for the organizers and of the Society for Promotion of Horticulture, Bangalore. And I especially thank Dr. VK Singh, my director of ICF CREDA, for enabling me to be a part of this workshop as well. And thank you, Dr. Sridhar and Dr. Atikula, for being the conveners of this workshop, for having me here. And it's a great pleasure for me and a privilege for me to share this platform with Dr. Dinesh Sharma. I am someone who has been listening to him for the past decade throughout my time as a student, and while I was also doing my little bit to science communication, I've been listening to him, reading about him, reading what he has written. So it's really wonderful that I get this chance to share this platform with him. Before I start, I think there are a few people who have been waiting to ask questions. Dr. Narayana Swami has been raising his hand during Dr. Dinesh Sharma's talk. Would he like to ask any questions? Dr. Narayana Swami? I suppose not. Sir, can we ask the director, Dr. Murthy, sir, to speak? I will start.
No, it's okay, madam. I want to listen to you. Yes.
Okay.
Although I am busy, there were about 4 meetings today morning, almost scheduled overlappingly.
I see.
Now manage with 3, and I want to listen to you, then I will speak.
Thank you, sir. Okay, sure. So, before I start, I think we have a lot of people here who are from the science background, mostly from the science background, less from the communication field. So out of all the scientists and students here, I'd like to ask how many of you have actually tried your hand at science communication. You can use the chat box to put in a yes if you don't want to answer on screen. You can answer in the chat box. Just put a yes if you've ever tried your hand at science communication. Okay, I've got 1 response, 2, 3. 4, 5. Okay, I'm getting people. People are answering. I'm happy to see that a lot of people have actually tried doing this. So, yes, please go on. If you have done it, please keep on saying yes. And now, I'd like to ask, what kind of challenges have you faced when you tried communicating science? What is the reaction you got? How did people respond when you tried communicating science? Was it something you wrote or was it something you spoke? How did people react? Can anybody tell me what kind of reaction they got and what are the challenges they faced or what they felt was a problem with their communication? Can someone volunteer to speak?
Preeti, unmute yourself.
Yes, Preeti. Miss Preeti? We can't hear you. Can you unmute yourself? I think you're muted. No?
It is the organizers, they are muted.
No, she can speak as well, I think.
Okay, Preeti, would you like to chat and put it in the chat box? Would you like to put your comments in the chat box? Okay, lack of novelty, problems in organizing of contents is a comment from Ms. Sanchika Snehi. Okay. And Dr. Atik has written, since it's intangible, people in general aren't much keen on it. All right. Communication made was asked to be made more simple. That's a very good observation. Ms. Roshni Vijayan, thank you. Tending to be more scientific. Yes, since we are from the science background, we tend to become more wordy about what science is. Yes. Going to their level of understanding when there's a diverse group. That's from Dr. Gopi Chand. Very, very nice. I think Ms. Preeti hasn't got back, but yes, whenever she comes back, we'll have her speak. People feel science is a burden and they left all that in the classroom. Very nice observation, Mr. Sachin Gupta. Yes. Convincing a heterogenic group is more difficult. That's great. We are able to recognize that there are lots of different people in our group. And science is a dry subject and they're not interested. Dr. Anuraja. Yes. all of these reactions which I'm getting, these are exactly the problems which all of us, including myself as a communicator, face when we try to communicate with general public or anybody for that matter. Whether you, even if you are talking to your, let's say, kids, your nieces, nephews, and they ask you, what are you doing? For maybe a lot of you who are scientists, maybe you interact with children in your family and they ask you, what do you do for a job? And you tell them you're a scientist and they ask you, okay, what do you do? How do you tell it to them? So if you're able to tell children what you're able to do or what you're doing in your field of science, and if they're able to understand, that means you're a very good communicator. That means you're an excellent communicator, because children are the hardest people to communicate to. Because you need to know what their level of understanding is. You need to know what they know so far and how you can use that knowledge as a base to tell them what you're doing. At the same time, you shouldn't be misleading them. At the same time, you shouldn't be sugarcoating what you're doing too much. They should still have a very intelligent understanding of what you're doing in your job. So this is one thing, area where you might have come across, where you have been trying to communicate to people, where you talk to children and then you realize, how do I tell them what I'm doing? So I'll tell you my own experience when I found a problem with communication. I told you I'm from ICI Creda, Central Research Institute for Dryland Agriculture. We have a very beautiful campus here. And it's lovely when you just come into our campus, you have a huge garden of rose plants on the right side, all blooming all throughout the year. You have lovely Ashoka trees lined all along the way, roadway. And it's just a huge impact when we just come into the campus. And every day, I travel by an Ola auto to come to Creda. And every day when I come inside the campus in my auto, the auto driver asks me, Amma, what is this place? What is this office? What do you do here? They are so impressed by the campus, by the plants, by the flowers. They are absolutely awestruck by the whole lot of it. And because we only have the board outside which says I speak, and they don't understand what Center for Dryland Agriculture Research is. So every time they ask me this, what do you do here? What happens here? What is this office for? I start thinking, okay, what do I tell this person? How do I explain to him what happens in Creda? And then at first I tried saying something like, we have new varieties being invented here, because I am not a Telugu. And all of these guys who are dropping me, they're Telugus. I'm not a local Telugu. I'm actually a Malayali, but I was born and brought up here. Still, my Telugu is very bad. It's not all that great. So when I try to explain in Telugu what happens here, I'm sure the message is something else. But still, they're okay. They're not completely convinced, but they're okay with it. They'll say, fine. Okay, Amma, fine. And then they go. They're still looking all around and they go. Then I asked somebody from the science field, how do I explain to these people? Because every day, one new person asks me, what happens here in Creda? So then I asked the science person, and then he said something in scientific terms in Telugu. And he said, you parishodana, the word parishodana for research. And the next time I thought, okay, I will use this when the person asks me. So when the next auto driver dropped me and he asked me, what is this for? I use this very wonderful word parishodana, because I've learned a new Telugu word and I had to use it now. So I said parishodana, and he looked at me and said, lady, what are you talking? I don't know what you're talking. And then he didn't ask me anything more, and I thought, oh my god, I've messed it up. Now I don't want to talk like this. I don't want to talk like a scientist. Then I asked one of my own colleagues who is not from the scientific field, who's not from the technical field. He's just one somebody like me. He's not even from the communication field. I asked him, sir, what do I tell these people? Every day I get this question. He said, madam, you just tell one thing. The crops don't grow when there is no water. And here they try to find out how to make the crops grow when there is less water. Such a simple thing I could not think of. People from the science background could not think of, but this person who is not from any of these fields, he could tell me how to tell the auto guys what Creda stands for. This simplicity is what we are looking for in science communication. Finally, you need to tell people what is the final result or the final impact of all the research that you're doing. How is it connected to them? Now, when these people, they are not, I'm not saying they're illiterate, they're probably educated, maybe, but they may not have proper science background. But still, they know that the research which is happening here, or whatever the, whatever work is going on in this government office, is for ensuring that we have bread, better crops, better produce, and that this will finally affect them when they get better food on their table for themselves and their children. This is the impact we are looking for in science communication. And when Dr. Dinesh Sharma said, the public are not direct stakeholders, they are not direct stakeholders, it will not make any difference in, if you, in this field of science communication, whether I tell those auto drivers what CREDA stands for or not. But indirectly, there will always be a connection. They are taxpayers. They are people who know that there are intelligent scientists out there doing some important work. They don't know what that important work is. But it is our duty as scientists, as communicators, to let them know we are working for their benefit, for their welfare. And that is why we need science communication. And this kind of simplicity is what we are looking for in science communication. We need to be able to tell them in very simple terms, whether it's farmers, whether it's the common public, whether it's students, tell them what they need to know, what impacts them, how it will make a difference to them. That is what will constitute the crux of all your science communication. So if you are doing some research, think of how the findings of your research are going to impact this common man. The findings are what will be what you should highlight when you try to communicate. Everything else, when we as scientists look at work, we think of the background, we think of the methodology, we are fixated on the methodology and what other people have done. We are trying to compare how other research has happened and how we have done. All that is fine, but your final research findings, your major implications, how your research is going to affect the common man, will be the main point of your science communication. So here I'll start sharing my PPT. And I have got a few more reactions here. We will go into that. But I'll just go over a short, a few more points before we start with the next interaction. Okay, so like I said, what science communication is all about is bridging the gap between what scientists have to say and what the public needs to know. So if you look at it, what I spoke about how we simplify it, it's what we term as demystification of science. You have a lot of information in you. You have a lot of information in your research papers, in your publications. All that is fine, but you have to demystify it, because people think that science is something very complicated. I got that reaction as well. Somebody said science is very dry, and so people are not interested. Some people think science is too complicated. We don't want to go into it much. So demystifying science is our responsibility as a communicator. So make people feel that nothing is so complicated, but we try to tell them what is important for them, and the final implications of our research are to be highlighted. The second thing is, after this, we come to cutting out scientific jargon. Even this is something which Dr. Sharma said. How do we tell them something without making them feel we are talking very hi-fi things? So since we are science students or from the science field, we tend to use scientific language.
Sneha, can you make it full screen?
Sorry?
Can you make it full screen, the presentation?
Yes. Yes, sir.
Probably you need to share full screen itself, not the. Yes, yes, yes. Now it's good.
Yeah, it's fine now.
Yes, it has come.
But one second. It's. I think I'll have to stop sharing and then try once.
Put it in presentation mode.
I think it's okay now.
Not screen, not share.
It's yet to come up.
Okay, one second.
Total screen share, not the presentation alone.
Yeah.
Yes, it's coming up.
All right. Right.
Yes, yes.
Yeah. So, as I was saying, the third point is cutting out the scientific jargon. So if you're going to use all those complicated technical terms that which may be very familiar for us, we talk about DNA, we talk about histones, we talk about splicing, gene splicing, all that is fine for us. It's not fine for the common man. It's not fine for the audience if they are not from the scientific community. So every time you start communicating, you start writing, think, what words can you use? Suppose there is a word which you cannot avoid using and which is not something that people would normally understand, explain it. So even if you don't focus on it in the beginning, at least at wherever, at whichever point you introduce a new term, a new scientific term, and which you cannot avoid, you better explain it. So I'll show you some example for that. We'll come to that. Another thing is, when you are using jargon, there are words which are already known to the public. So let's say you were talking, giving some science communication feature or a story during the COVID pandemic time. So when the pandemic started, people were not aware what a coronavirus is. So there were always explanations. There was always a small background explaining what COVID-19 is, what is a coronavirus in the initial news stories which came out. Okay. But later on, as time passed, we are all familiar. Everybody is familiar with what is COVID, what is coronavirus. Everybody knows it's a class of viruses and not just the COVID-19. Why do we know all this? Because we have been continuously talking about it. These things have been explained. So now when you write about something related to COVID, you don't have to go back to explaining all these things. Similarly, the word vaccine. Vaccine is a very common thing. Everybody knows what a vaccine is. So you don't have to explain what a vaccine is. Yes, when the new vaccine came out, you had to explain how the vaccine worked. That is different. But when you use certain terms, see if those terms are familiar with the audience, and if you need to explain, you explain. But also don't underestimate your audience to the extent that you think, okay, they won't understand even this, so I will explain that. No, there's no need for that. You need to know till what extent your audience might already know certain things and how you can expand on that. Okay. Now, the lesser the jargon, you have better chances of persuasion. Why? Because we are, like somebody already explained when I asked, what are the challenges you face? People get put off or turned off when you have very complicated terminology being used, because they think, they already start thinking, okay, I'm not intelligent enough to understand this. This is going to be too tough for me. So what happens is mentally they are turned off. They immediately switch off and they don't want to go anymore into it. The same thing when they are reading. So if they feel that what has come in the newspaper or in the magazine is too complicated for them. They read the first paragraph or maybe the second, and then they stop it. Okay, I don't understand any more of this, so I'm not going to read the rest of it. So this is why we need to use less jargon. So if you are going to make it simpler, you're going to make it more understandable for the audience, then they will have lesser resistance to adopting whatever you are advocating. So especially as agricultural scientists, when you are trying to communicate about a new technology to be used in the fields or about some new variety or maybe genetically modified foods for that matter, if you're talking about any of these things, if you're going to be too technical in your terms, if you're going to make it too complicated, people don't get that trust factor. If you speak in terms which are common to both you and your target audience, that is the common man, then there is a better chance for them to trust you, to understand what you're trying to, make an effort to understand what you're trying to say, and to adopt whatever you are telling them to do. Otherwise, they simply blank out. They don't want to even try it out. So this is why when you are doing science communication, you have to be very careful that you don't use excessive jargon. And if at all you have to use any jargon, please explain it. Okay, and there has even been a research done on this, in fact, on how people do not get the trust factor because they don't appreciate jargon. And also the way you present the message affects their information processing. So let's say you're going to have a lot of information just jammed into something. Okay, so even if you make a poster, for example, even if you make a poster, if you're going to put a lot of information into it, people are sure to be turned off, especially if it's for the common man. There are poster presentations for the scientific community where, yes, you will end up putting in all the information along with graphs, along with data projections and pictures, maybe some proof from your lab. You may put all those things. But when it is for the common man, you do not use a lot of complicated graphs. You should not try to put in your exact all those boring pictures, but rather put infographics, which is a combination of information and some pictures and graphics, so that people are more interested, and less text, more visual effect. That should be the effect you are aiming for. Now, whether it is a new story that you're writing, so now as scientists or as science communicators, you would be writing or trying to craft science messages, communication messages for print media and also for electronic media or for social media. Now, whichever media it may be, okay, you have certain things to keep in your mind, which you have to put across through your communication. Now, whatever the story may be, now in journalistic parlance, we call everything a story. Please don't get confused. Whether it's an article or whether it's a feature or it's a news item in the newspaper, it's all called a story. Okay, so that's why I keep using the term story. That's where I'm explaining my jargon now. So yeah, so when we are talking about any story, a science story, we have to go by the basic communication principle of using 5 W's and 1 H. Okay, so what are these 5 W's and 1 H? This is something you always need to remember every time you are communicating. Who, what, when, where, and why. These are the 5 W's. Who, what, when, where, and why. And the 1 H is how. If you are able to answer these questions through your message, through your story, then it means that the purpose is met. At least the basic purpose of communicating a specific finding is met. So what is the discovery or what is the research finding that you are trying to communicate? What is that important point which you want to tell people? That should be the main point. Then who did it? Who found this? Is it your institute or is it somebody else? Are you reporting from some article which you have read, some research article that you have read in a journal? If that is the case, you have to say which university or which research institute made the breakthrough who are the scientists who worked on it, and who benefits from it. In some cases, you won't know who has specifically done it. You may only have a vague idea as to who has done it, but you can definitely mention who benefits from those research findings. Okay, then when did this happen? Now, even this when is something which may not be there in all science communications, because when it comes to science, the advantage is you can write about something which has happened as recently as yesterday or today, or you can still write about the basic information that is there in a particular broad field of study, which has already been there in public knowledge for a long time, but you can repackage it in a way that you find interesting or which you think the target audience will find interesting. So just because there have been write-ups about deforestation or climate change in the past doesn't mean that you cannot write about it now. You can still write about it. You can still talk about it. So it doesn't, so the when part is not very important when it comes to science communication, but if there is a point where it has to make an impact on people, like let's say, for example, if the vaccine, they have found a new vaccine, which is an oral vaccine. So how long will it take for this oral vaccine to reach people? This is where the time part will come into play. So you'll have to mention that, or at least if you don't know about it, you'll still have to say that there is still a debate going on as to when the oral vaccine can actually reach the common man. You can say something like that as well, but make sure that you can put a connection somewhere. Then, where is this research happening? Or where can we expect the impact of this research? Now, if you have the research happening in your own city, your institute, you have to talk about it, because first of all, it elevates the importance of the findings, because if you're from an established organization, it is helpful for not just the finding to be taken seriously, but also for your organization to come into public view. This means that people will start following you for more breakthroughs, for more research findings, for more stories about science. You will start building up credibility. So you need to talk about where the research has happened or is happening, where you're writing from, and where you can expect the impact of this research. Who is going to be benefited from it, and where, from which place? Is it here in the city or in this state or in the country, or is it a particular demographic? Like, is it senior citizens or is it people who are working professionals? Who can benefit from something like this? That is what you need to highlight. Then, why is this discovery or research finding important? This is a very important factor you need to include in any of your science communications, because this is what will finally completely embed the message in the minds of the reader or the audience. They need to know why something is important in order to remember it. And that is why you need to tell them why it is important. Then if you can, you can explain about how the discovery was made. Here, again, we don't go into the details. Like, we can't talk about the methodology and what chemicals were used, what reagents were used, what techniques were used. Unless it is something really important, you don't have to go into all that. But you can talk about what was the sample which was selected, if it's something related to partly social science also, like let's say effect of the vaccine on people. You need to talk about what was the sample size selected for the study, how many people were taken into account, how many were administered which vaccine, and what kind of effects were seen, or over a period of how many days were they monitored. These are things which you can put in a very brief manner, maybe one or two lines or a paragraph at the most, but this is something you can put in simple terms. So this is 5 W's and 1 H. Now, I would like you all to tell me, in this particular story, I've put a new story here. Omicron can displace Delta. Study suggests how Omicron enhances neutralizing immunity against Delta. Can you identify 5 W's and 1 H here? I'm sorry, I can't see the chat box simultaneously. So I will continue to share. One second. If I would prefer that you speak instead of putting it in the chat box, so that I will know that somebody is responding. Can somebody tell me what part, can somebody highlight the what part and tell me what is the main point being put forth here? Or we can start with who. Who is the important part here? Who is doing this research?
South African scientist.
Very good. Can you please tell your name also before you answer?
Yeah, I'm Suvedita from IIHR.
Okay, great. Thank you. South African scientist, yes. So that is the who part. Now, can somebody say what? You can see in the first paragraph itself, the major finding or the what part is given. Yes, is somebody ready to speak?
Can I answer again? Or okay, someone else.
Yeah.
Go ahead, Suvedita.
Okay, so they are telling about the Omicron can displace Delta as the first, the title itself tells.
Yes, that is the title. In the matter, in the first paragraph, can you spot the main finding which they are trying to put forth?
It neutralizes the immunity against the Delta. Omicron infection enhances neutralizing immunity against Delta.
Yes, that is the what part. That means they are trying to tell you that if you have an Omicron infection, it helps in extra immunity against the Delta variant. Okay, so that is the what part, and that becomes the most important part of your science communication. Okay, of this particular story, that is the major takeaway. Fine. Now, is there a when which you can identify here? Anything which says when?
Some past it says.
Sorry?
The work has had.
It's a 2 weeks period. 2 weeks period after infection. That is what? 14 days.
Okay. That is in the part of how it has happened. Yes, they have given the time period. And as to when they have reported it, you can only see it from the dateline and from the quotes which have been given. They have said on Twitter on Monday. So that's the only clue you have. But there's nothing more with regard to when. So like I said, the when part may not necessarily come through in all science stories. Very good. Thank you. Then we have finished who, what, when, and can we talk about where?
The study was underwent in South Africa.
Yes, of course. That is very clearly given in the first line itself. So you also get the point of where in the very first paragraph. The research is conducted by South African scientists, so it's obviously happening there. And also, there is this little bit of background at the bottom where they have written about the Omicron variant itself, and they have written where it was first detected in Southern Africa and Hong Kong in November. Okay. Now, why? Why is this important? Why is this finding important that Omicron can displace Delta?
Because it's worldwide and it is threatening.
Which is threatening, Omicron or Delta?
The Omicron variant.
Delta.
Yes, somebody is telling Delta. Tell me why Delta. Can somebody say why Delta needs to be displaced? The Delta variant has been found to be more fatal. Is that right? We have heard about the Omicron variant's symptoms. They are not very serious. But the Delta variant symptoms are much more serious and fatalistic. Is that right?
Yes, ma'am. Virulence of Omicron is lesser than Delta one.
Yes, exactly. So if you look at the fifth paragraph here, according to an earlier South African study, there is a reduced risk of hospitalization and severe disease in people infected with Omicron coronavirus variant compared with the Delta one. Okay, so they're trying to give a reason as to why the displacing of the Delta with the Omicron can actually be beneficial to people. Okay, so this is the why part. This is the why part of the story. So we have covered five W's, and what is the one H? They have talked about how they have looked at the whole thing. The analysis enrolled 33 vaccinated and unvaccinated people who were infected with the Omicron variant in South Africa, and they found that the neutralization of Omicron increased 14-fold over 14 days. So this entire paragraph is the how part of it. How did they find this out? So you see the five W's and one H in this particular news story. I think I need a response.
Yes, sir. Yeah.
I can't see the chat box. That's why. Yeah. Okay. So great. So I hope this is clear to everyone. I know there's a limit in the online workshop as to how much I can gauge your reactions, but fine. And I thank all those who responded for this, right? So if you look at some more things to add when you're writing a science story, so five W's and one H should be there, whether it is, you know, a news story you're writing for the newspaper, which is like immediate news, something which happened yesterday and you need to report it, you need to say that your institute has found, has made this breakthrough in it, and it goes to the newspaper in the form of a press release, whatever it may be, these five W's and one H should be there. And even if you're writing, let us say, a popular science article or a feature story, even then the five W's and one H should be there, not in the in this particular order. It need not always be in the first few paragraphs, but it should definitely come through, even if it is a soft news story like a feature or a blog or what, or a popular science article. Okay, now what else can you add in your news science stories? You can add some background information, because see, when you tell something new which has happened, which has taken place, which you want to tell people about, you still need to tell them what already is there, what is the base for you to make this this new finding public. What is the base for that to happen? What is the context? You need to explain the context. Then you need to give any other related information which you think which would be useful for understanding this story better. Quotes. Quotes here mean which people of certain significance. It could be policymakers. It could be scientists. It could be people who are somehow directly or indirectly related with the story that you're writing. If they are giving you a quote, that means they tell you something and you put it verbatim in your story. You write it exactly as it is using quote unquote. That becomes a quote. And if you put in quotes, it adds to the value of your communication, because it shows that there is a direct source for whatever you are talking about, for whatever you are writing about. That means you have done your research. It's not just something you have read somewhere and written, but you have actually spoken to people who are involved in this research and you are quoting them. Okay. And when it comes to feature stories or blogs, which can be longer, where you can put in a lot of information, you can also include case studies and examples. So whenever you are writing, try to make it a little creative, a little interesting, especially for your feature stories and popular articles. For the mainstream news, like something which has to come on the newspaper, maybe in the main newspaper, in the front page, or open page, like when you are reporting your scientific breakthroughs, make it clear, interesting, yes, but to the point. Not something which is too descriptive or which beats around the bush. Okay? So overall, these are the things which you need to ensure goes into your science communication. Your information should be factual, balanced. Balanced here means you have it's not biased towards or slanted towards any particular viewpoint. Okay? And it should be transparent. So all of this proves how trustworthy your communication is. Then how you put forth your information, the presentation and style. It should reach the audience. It should reach out to them. Like they should be able to connect with it. So that is where you have your challenge. And that you can overcome only with repeated practice of writing or speaking. And finally, is it society? Your communication effort, whether it is a write-up or whether it is a social media post, how is it impacting people? Are you able to relate to people with it? Okay. Now, I have some exercise here, but I think we will be short of time if we go into all of that. So I will just move over that. I'll go on to the next exercise, which I thought I will show you. Now, this is a news article from the University of Vienna. Okay. I'd like you to go through and tell me if you can spot scientific jargon, how much can you spot in it? Do you think they have communicated well? Or do you think they have explained the jargon well? I'd like you to take 5 minutes to read through. Think from the point of view of a layperson, not as a science person.
Ma'am, can I answer?
Rizal, what is happening?
I think she has, we lost her connection, sir.
Yeah, plus it's showing several.
Yeah.
The meeting.
Left the meeting. We have now 128 only.
We can call her and find out. Sridhar?
Atikula is doing
it. No, no. We are not, means you are, we lost your connection. PowerPoint is not there. It's not there. Not there. Yes. Yes. You join, ma'am, again. I think at Sneha's side there was some issue. She'll be joining.
I'm so sorry. I think there was a problem with the internet connection.
Yes, another colleague from Creda also just like joined. Maybe that may be the problem.
Okay. Okay, I'll go back to sharing my PowerPoint now.
Few of them has put their comments in the chat box.
Okay. All right. I think I cannot see the messages now because I just rejoined. Could the people who put the messages in the chat box, could you speak instead of putting it in the chat box? I'll share my PPT once again.
Ms. Amruta, Navya Rukmini, Manju Rajesh, can you please speak up? Vasant is saying first three paragraphs are a bit difficult. Last paragraph is okay for layman as well.
Nandeshwar is okay
for layman. Okay. Nandeshwar is commenting it is for scientific group than general audience.
Okay.
There are many terms like epigenetic methylation and things which has to be explained in more detail because it's difficult for the layman to understand what it is.
Very good. Exactly. So I think we have all been able to figure out that there are certain terms here which all qualify as jargon, scientific jargon. So like she said, was it Amruta who spoke?
I spoke actually, Suvedita.
Suvedita.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you, Suvedita. Epigenetics. Yes. Not everybody knows what is epigenetics. We still talk about, people do talk about DNA, but they don't know anything about epigenetics. And when you talk about genomic imprinting, they have not explained what is genomic imprinting. They have only said termed genomic imprinting, and they have said the first one is DNA methylation. Now, how many people would know what is DNA methylation? Even they wouldn't know that. What is cytosine? Do people know that it is one of the nucleotides? We don't know. Normal people wouldn't think of it. And then repression of transcription. All of this is scientific jargon. We cannot have writing like this for the common layman. Okay. So instead of this, for the same story, the same information, I'd like to show you another story. Okay. The same information packaged differently. Now I'd like you to read this.
Ma'am, slide share.
Can you cannot see the slide? Okay, one second.
No, we can see, not in a full mode.
Oh, it's not in a full mode. One second. Right. Is it okay now?
Yes, yes.
All right. So here you can see that in the first paragraph, it's a little more simpler. Do you think so? They have spoken about what this finding is going to imply for people. It says that a finding that takes them a step closer to unraveling some of the mysteries of epigenetics, and they have explained what is epigenetics. An area of science that describes how genes are switched on and off in different cells at different stages in development and adulthood. So this sentence is explaining what epigenetics is. They are explaining the jargon which they cannot avoid using. Epigenetics is what is the crux of the story, so they have to talk about epigenetics. But here they have explained what it is. Okay? Then they go on to talk about imprinted genes. What are imprinted genes? So they have devoted one paragraph to explaining what is genomic imprinting. Why only some genes are active and why it is called as genomic imprinting. They have explained this part. How certain genes are turned on or off from which parent. And why? So this is what they have explained here. So they have taken the effort to explain two major topics or two major concepts which are crucial to understanding this research finding. Okay. So if you go, it's a little bit longer, yes, than the previous news story. That was a short one. But here you can see this is a little longer. If you read it, you'll see that they have gone on to explain very nicely without making it too complicated. Yes, they cannot avoid certain things like DNA methylation and imprinting and epigenetics, but they have tried to explain using still simpler terms. Like scientists have known for some time that histones act as dimmer switches for genes, fading them off or back on. So these are all, you know, very simple language which you can use. It's not very complicated. At the same time, they have given the actual crux of the finding as well. So this is just something I wanted to show you to say how jargon needs to be explained, how you need to identify the jargon in your own writing and try to look at it from the point of view of a layperson. From the point of view of a common man as to how they can understand what they may or may not understand, you need to identify and simplify your communication accordingly. Okay. Now, there is another factor which you need to think of when you are doing science communication. This is not always necessary for any kind of science writing. I mean, you can always write about even the boring areas of science. There is nobody's going to stop you from it as long as you make it interesting. But certain things which make a new story valuable. Like, see, why does something make it to the front page of the newspaper? This is something we call as news values. So there are certain concepts or values which make something newsworthy. That means it should be there on the newspaper, in the newspaper tomorrow or in the news channel tomorrow. So this is how in communication or journalism, we decide something should make it to the table of the public. How do we decide on that? So these are where the news values come in. So if there is something unusual which is happening, okay, something strange which is happening, that qualifies as news. Something which is happening in your city, your town, even your colony. So suppose something, there are civic works happening in your colony or lack of civic works in your colony. It's in a bad state.
that gets reported, right? Similarly, if somebody is coming, the president of India is coming to visit your hometown, it becomes an important piece of news. So that is prominence. So these news values I have listed around here. Okay, I'll just go into it briefly so that you understand what news values are. So there are about 8 or so news values. Human spirit, human emotion or human spirit, or you can call it human interest value. This is very important for science communication. Because when you are talking about science, you're not just talking about science. We already said we are talking about how they impact people. Okay, so when we talk about human emotion as a value or as an important part of science communication, it means you're trying to tap into the emotional connect with people. So when you talk of case studies, when you talk, give examples of people, when you use analogies, okay, Ravi was a farmer who was having a very poor crop output, but then he used this particular fertilizer or he used this technique and then his crop started giving him 200% output. So when you give some example like this, where you're using a human being, you're using a person, you're using that person's experiences to explain science, automatically a connection is formed between yourself and your target audience. That is what you need to think of when you are doing science communication. That is one of the most important news values when you do science communication. So it's not just telling them that this is the impact which will be there on you, but you're trying to put an emotional connect. How did we communicate about wearing masks during the pandemic? So in the beginning, it was all scientific. Everybody was telling you should wear the mask, the virus is this size, and if you use the N95 mask, it will not go through. All of this was happening, but then the messages started being framed in a different manner. They started saying, wear your mask, not for yourself, but to protect your loved ones. So what happened here was, they changed the tone of the messaging. It was no longer preaching. You're not preaching people, do like this, do like that, you're supposed to do like this. No, you're telling them why or how this can give some benefit to them in an emotional manner. So when you tell them this is to protect your family, your children, your mother, your aged mother and father, when you tell such things, people have a better tendency to listen and to adopt what you're telling them. But if you start preaching to them, this is what you're supposed to do, this is what science says, then people will not listen. So this is where you should use this human emotion or human interest value in your communication. Okay. Apart from this, there are all the other ones which generally all the other news values which are mentioned here. I will explain each one briefly, like unusual, oddity. Okay. So if there was once a report on a child who was crying tears of stones. Okay. Now, this is not something which happens all the time. You don't come across cases like this. But this report made it to the newspaper because it is unusual. There is something odd about it. So the same way, suppose you're communicating something from the farm, from the field. Suppose you find something unusual, a new kind of maybe the variety of fruit that you were expecting, maybe it has some new features. So if you report that, that becomes an oddity and that can have some news value. That means people would be interested in knowing about it. So you have to exploit these odd things which happen to highlight the science and use this as an opportunity to explain a little more of the science through your communication. Okay, so oddity is also something which you can use to your advantage. Then currency. What is the current topic which is happening? What is the latest thing in the news? This is something which you really need to take into account, especially when you're doing your social media posts. Because the more you are in sync with what is happening around you, the more people are influenced. People will be more interested in what's happening right now, and you post something about it, they will definitely be even more interested. So suppose there is, let's say right now, there's this all this information coming out about the new telescope, the James Webb telescope. If you use this opportunity to highlight something related to that on your own institute's Twitter handle or Facebook account, what happens is that people are interested. It need not necessarily be something which is related to your institute, but you are still talking science. You're still communicating science. So don't let go of such opportunities where you can be a part of the current debate and discussion. That is something you need to factor in for your communication efforts. Timeliness, okay? How quickly can you report something? Now, this is basically for journalists. They are the ones who need to be extra careful about the timeliness. But you also, as scientists, as students, when you are reporting something, you need to do it quickly. Like before, when our previous speaker, Dr. Sharma, said, the fake news can spread twice as fast. The fake news gets there before the reporters do, and the reporters get there before you do. So finally, everybody else gets their say, but not the actual scientists. So it's time that you utilize this news value of timeliness, take it seriously, and use it to your advantage to get there first, to put your views out there first. So use every kind of new media. That new media includes everything related to the internet, social media, all kinds of social media, including your WhatsApp, to put out your news there first. Your website, all of this should be used. Then proximity, yes, something which is happening closer to you, closer in your city, in your country, all that would definitely have more value in science communication, like as a news story for people who are reading, rather than something which is happening in Uganda or the Caribbean. Okay, why would people be bothered about something which is being done there? They would be more interested in what's happening here in India, or what's happening here in Telangana, or in your state, or in your city, Bangalore, whatever. So people think of how is it going to affect me, and you should use this news value of proximity also when you are trying to communicate. Then anything which can be conflict, which can, you know, raise debate. There are lots of things like that, like the issues of sustainability, climate change. These are things which are ongoing debates. You can utilize these also for as topics for your science communication. Okay, so this is then there is magnitude. How many people are actually impacted? See, when reporting about the pandemic, we know that almost everybody is affected. So it becomes major news. And that is how magnitude affects. So whatever research you are talking about, maybe it's your own research, you need to see if this is something which can affect a lot of people in the future. Let's say you found something, you found some plant compound which can cure cancer in the future. That means this is going to impact a lot of people. A lot of people are going to benefit from it. So use this information to your advantage as the most important point in your communication. That is how you should frame your news stories. Okay. Now, there's some rules of writing to keep in mind whenever you are writing. I know people will think, okay, we are only talking about writing. But let me tell you, writing is the base for everything. Even if you are having a radio show, or whether you are having a television show, you still need to have a script, and the script starts with writing. So even if it's your social media post, you are the one who needs to do the writing and framing of messages. So just a few simple rules: prefer simple sentences, don't go for long sentences with a lot of information crammed into a single sentence and all that. No, single sentence, simple sentence with a single idea. A single concept should be expressed in a single sentence. That is how you should go about. Use active voice. Use action verbs. So when you use active voice, there's a little more, you know, there's an enthusiastic tone to what you're saying. Like you say, scientists are finding this particular are researching this particular gene or something like that, instead of this gene or its genes effects or something, or genomic imprinting is being researched by scientists. Instead of putting it in the passive voice, you put it in the active voice, where it looks like people are actively doing something. That is the way you write. So that comes with practice. You'll have to keep reading and you'll have to keep writing. Then prefer short sentences. And when you're writing for blogs or feature stories, you can use a mix of both long and short sentences. But for immediate information, or for information to for laymen, for farmers, you have to go for simple communication. Okay, prefer concrete statements. Don't go for vague, abstract kind of explanations. Just be very clear and to the point. Without any, you should ensure that there is no confusion about the basic concepts. Then understand what the audience is looking for from you, why they are actually listening to you. There is a reason. So try to understand what they need, why they need it, and then you give them that information. Okay. So like I said before, try to understand what the audience already knows before you put in new information. Okay. And counter the fake news, counter the misconceptions. We have a lot of superstitions still in our understanding of science. In people still would prefer to go by those superstitious facts rather than scientific facts. So try to counter them in a constructive manner when you are communicating. And use these logical connectors. And, but, because, however, these things, when in, it should add to the flow of your language. So remember, whenever you're writing, or even when you're constructing a message for a radio script or a television script or for social media, if you have information which is a little lengthy, you're not going to put it in a single sentence or a single paragraph. Ensure that there is connection between one paragraph and the other. Connection in the sense, connection in the ideas which are being presented. It shouldn't be abrupt. So it should pick up. If you're starting a new paragraph, the new paragraph should pick up from where the previous paragraph ended. It shouldn't start something completely new. Okay. So when we look at, I'm not going to go into much of these science news and features, because you already know what kind of things constitute news and what constitutes features. Okay, I'll just tell you, what is a hard news story and what is a soft news story? Okay. Now, anything which has to come in your newspaper, news channel as something which comes in your headlines, in your first page of the newspaper, something which cannot wait for tomorrow. Okay. Anything that cannot wait for tomorrow becomes a hard news story. That means once you miss reporting it, once you miss talking about it today, and you think you'll give it tomorrow, by then the news has become stale. People already know about it and it no longer has any relevance. That is called a hard news story. Okay. So when it comes to science, you have major scientific breakthroughs, okay, which need to be reported immediately. If you don't do it, somebody else will do it. So these breakthroughs, these new advancements in technology, all of this becomes a hard news story. Okay, suppose some decision has been taken on science policy in by our government. So that also becomes a hard news story. Okay, but let's say you're going to do an analytical piece on what has been done so far in a particular field. Let's say you want to analyze, you want to do a story on analyzing how the pandemic has been managed, how the different vaccines have worked. You want to do a story on that. Now, this can wait. It need not happen the same day you write it. You need not publish it, because this is already going on. The concept, the topic is very much in the news. So even if you don't publish it today, you can do it tomorrow or by the weekend also. It will still be relevant. People will still read it and it will still be useful. So that constitutes your soft news story, which can be a feature story, something which comes in the supplementary pages of your newspaper, something which comes as a special feature on television, these things become your feature stories, with these things become your blogs, your popular science articles. Okay, and that is called a soft news story. So I'm going to show you how you actually frame these soft news stories and hard news stories. What is the structure for it? Would you like a break for 2 minutes before we start this?
I think we can have a quick break for maybe 2-3 minutes so that people get. We will quickly join in 3-4 minutes. Water break. Sneha, you can resume.
Yes, sir, we'll resume. Okay. So I hope people are all back. So I just want to give you the structure you need to follow when you are crafting your messages for a news story, especially a hard news story, and when you're making content for a press release. So as institutes, which you will definitely be giving out press releases from time to time, you'll be reporting your findings, your research findings to the press. So remember that your press release content and your hard news story have a similar style. And this style is called as the inverted pyramid style. Okay. So you remember we discussed the 5 W's and the 1 H. Now, this is your most important information, which comes into the first 1 or 2 paragraphs. And this is called as the lead. Please remember, the lead is very important. So whatever you write, the lead is very important. So especially for a hard news story or for a press release, the lead tells your reader or your audience why this information or this news story is important for them. So you have to ensure that they read it in the first 2 paragraphs. Remember that people may not have the time to read everything. And if you're sending a press release to media organizations, remember that they also have a gatekeeping function. Now they will think, okay, is this important enough to come in the newspaper tomorrow? If not, cut it out. This is how they function, because they have a lot of information, a lot of news stories coming in. Different people, all institutes will keep sending in press releases. So why should yours be considered to make it to the newspaper tomorrow? So when they have such less time, they will not spend their time reading your entire press release to see if everything is important, how they can change it and all that. Most of the time, if your press release is crafted well, it goes just as it is to become a news story. And if they feel it is too long, they will simply slash out the last few paragraphs. So if they're going to do that, you should make sure that your important information is not stuck in the last few paragraphs. You have to make sure that the most important information you want to convey, that is your major findings, how it is going to impact people, that should come in your first paragraph, which is called the lead. And that is what we already discussed, the 5 W's and 1 H. Once you have covered this part, then you can go into more details, like in the body. The second or the third paragraphs or the fourth paragraphs also, you can go into a little more detail. You can talk about some background information. You can give quotes of what people have said. Maybe if you can take the quotes of the scientists who have worked in your institute on that particular research, put that there. And you can also include the quotes of people who might be involved in some way. So if it is something which has a connection to policy, try to get the quote of a policymaker, or you get the quote of the organizations, which different heads of organizations who might be involved in that particular research, because they will have something to say about the findings which the organizations have got in collaboration. So you have to put those things in the body part. Okay, so that, why do we do this? Because if, let us say, due to lack of space, the newspaper, the editor cuts out even the second and the third paragraph, your first paragraph is still intact. So that means the crux of your information is still going through. It is still going to reach people. Only the extra information will get cut. So this is why we follow the inverted pyramid style. First, to ensure that you get a space, if you are doing a press release, ensure that you get a space in the media. The second part is, if you're doing a hard news, if it is a hard news story, that people at least read the first paragraph, even if they don't go into the rest of it. As people who are reading newspapers and who watch television news, I'm sure we all know how much we actually watch, how much we actually read. We read the headline, we read the first few lines, and then, okay, time to go. We go on to the next, we just turn the page, or we go on to the next channel. This is what happens with all of us. So keep that in mind when you are communicating as well. People will not have time to read the entire thing or watch the entire program to know what is happening. So put it in the lead, and in the body, you put all the other extra information, which is still relevant to your story. So you can give some background information. You can explain how the research was conducted, what were the problems. You can go into a little more detail. The last part is the tail. The tail will include extra information which may not be necessary. You can give some statistics. You could give some extra connecting link to something else which has happened. So those things will come in the tail. And if the tail gets chopped off, we have no problem. The lead and the body will still be intact. Okay. So this is the format you need to follow when you are writing for a news story, a hard news story, or for a press release. Now, the press release itself has a certain format. There is a template for it. So I don't know how many of you might have done press releases, or if you plan to do any in the future. Please remember that there is this format which you need to follow, and that will also add to the professionalism of your press releases which you send out. So ensure that you have your institute logo on the top. On the left side, you have the release date. That is, you tell them this has to go immediately, or you have to tell them by when it has to be released. You can give them the weekend date, like suppose you wanted to go in a special edition of the, maybe they have a science page and you wanted to go for that. You can mention that here, which date you wanted to go for. And on the right, you have your contact info, probably of the public relations officer or the head of the organization on the right side, with the details of a contacting. And then please don't forget your headline. This is something which is usually forgotten by people. People forget that they have to give a headline. Even if it is a press release, you still need to give a headline. Think that you are writing for the newspaper. Don't think this is a press release. Think you are writing for the newspaper and write in that way. Think this is how I want it to come in the newspaper. This is how I want it to be presented. You use that, put that in your head, and then you write. And then it will be carried as it is, and you will have a much better impact. You will get it published as you want. So put a proper headline, not too long. Again, ensure that it's short, maybe 6 to 7 words at the most. Try to compress and make the headline interesting yet informative. So it shouldn't look too complicated, but people should be attracted to read what is there below the headline. Okay. Now, there is something called a deck or a subheader where you can add little more information. Okay. So even if you give the headline might be short, but in the subheader or in the deck, you can give one more line of explanation giving the context. So that will be enough to hook the reader. Okay. Now, when you start with the actual content, again, don't forget the dateline. The dateline is also equally important as the headline. So your city, state, your month and date. This should be there on this left side. And then you start writing. So there you have the format which we already followed. We already spoke about. You have the lead. You follow the inverted pyramid style. You have the lead with the 5 W's and 1 H in the first paragraph, then followed by the body where you go for the remaining information with the quotes and your conclusion, maybe the tail part, which gives a little extra information. Then you have a boilerplate. Now this boilerplate is something where you talk about your organization. So if the press release is going from IIHR, you give a small paragraph detailing what IIHR is. So you can say ICR-IIHR is an organization under Indian Council of Agricultural Research involved in researching whatever it is. So you highlight your major areas of research, and you can speak about anything else which you think is relevant about your organization. Now, this boilerplate should be common for all your press releases. It should be the same. You should decide on a boilerplate in consultation with your heads. You should always have a common boilerplate which has to be used consistently for all your communications. And then you need to have this end notation here. This end notation is 3 hashtags. Okay, so you put those 3 hashtag symbols. It shows that your communication has ended here. There is nothing more to add. This has to be there. If you can actually put this end notation even above your boilerplate, but the thing is that if suppose the news organization wants to add some background about your institute in the news story, they will include that boilerplate information also, which is why we are putting this notation at the bottom below the boilerplate. Okay. Then the final note is telling them if you would like more information, you give some more contact details as to whom to contact about this. So here you can change this part. You can change, let's say, depending on the scientist, whoever has worked on the findings which you are communicating, you can inform, you can give their information here instead of the common PRO information. Okay. So this is the press release template. Now, when we come to writing a soft news story, so this includes a feature story, an article, a popular science article, or a blog. So remember, these are not serious stories which have to make it to the front page of the newspaper or which have to make it to the headlines in a news story on television. This is something which can be read later by people. They can read it for enjoyment and for information, both. So this is a form of writing which gives you some flexibility. You can use humor, you can use a lot of different techniques where you can make your writing interesting. You can have written a story form, like, you know, the actual story where you have a narrative, you put in characters, you put in a plot, and you try to explain some story. You can do that, and putting science is the base for it. Okay. Or you can use, you can start your story or your article with a delayed lead. Now, what is this delay lead? Now, earlier you saw we used the 5 W's and 1 H in the first paragraph itself, in the lead. Here, you don't have to put everything in the first paragraph, because now this is a relaxed form of reading. You don't want to put all the information into the person's head at one go. No, you want to get them interested in what you're writing, in what you have to say. So you can start with maybe a case study. You can start talking about how certain farmers in certain areas, they had problems with a particular crop or with a particular disease pest, and they how they overcame that problem. And then from there, you can go on to your actual story, which could be something about managing disease pests. So by giving this example in the first lead, you are getting them interested in a human interest experience. So that acts as your hook. That acts as the pull for your story. It could be that, or you can give some cultural reference. Let us say you want to talk about some, maybe a fertilizer, for example. I am not the scientist here, so I'm just giving a very vague example, but you can make it more interesting and you can pinpoint the right scientific fact. So let us say, for example, NPK fertilizers. You want farmers to use it, or you want people to understand its use. You want to talk about it. Why don't you start with comparing this with a different reference which they are familiar with? For example, you take Sanjeevani. Now, Sanjeevani is the magical herb which Hanuman brought from the Hamarathwa mountain. Okay. So everybody knows what Sanjeevani does. It is supposed to bring the dead, even the dead, back to life. So if you start with that and you say, do you want the plants also to come back? You want your plants to come back to life. You have to use this Sanjeevani, which is nothing but your NPK fertilizer. So something like that. You can use this kind of an analogy to get people interested in what you have to say. And then you go on to the actual stuff. Okay. So now here you have, now where do you put your 5 W's and 1 H in your soft news story? Here it goes into the nut graph. This nut graph is your second paragraph. Your second or third paragraph would be your nut graph. In your nut graph, it's called a nut graph. Okay. That means the nut here means the crux of the story. So your 5 W's and 1 H, the context of the story, will come here in your second and third paragraphs in the nut graph. And then you go on to more details. You can explain with more facts. You can explain in comparison to something else which is similar, using statistics, using data. All this will come in the third third step, which is the fourth or the fifth paragraphs. And finally, you will have an ending, a conclusion, where again, you can make it a little informal. You can tell people, you can make it humorous. You can try to put it like a piece of advice. You can fashion it in a way you want, as long as it is interesting. Okay, so this is how you go about writing for a soft news story or for a blog. Now, especially when it comes to blogs, you have different ways of writing blogs. So you can go for something which is in the current current news right now, which you can pick up some concept which you think you want to start a debate on, or you can do something which shows like numbers, like say 10 ways to make your crops better. Okay, so when you put something like this, it's like a bait for people. Okay, you have 10 different ways to do something, and 10 ways in which peanuts are a better substitute for protein. So if you're doing something like this, you are giving people a kind of information. You're telling them, I'm going to give you 10 different ways to do something. So this is how you can make your blogs interesting, or even feature articles, feature stories for that matter. In some cases, you can use this technique. Not all the time, but a few can be fashioned in this way. Then pick up those concepts which are usually not highlighted in the regular mainstream science communication for your blogs and feature stories. Try to build that into a better long blog and enhance on that. I will show you some examples. Now, this is something which is close to a blog and a feature story. You can see that they have a lead where they start. This is the story of a man who couldn't see numbers. Now, this is something which arouses your curiosity. Okay, so this is something which is like a feature story where you have a delayed lead. You're not telling them what it is about. You're not telling people what it is about. You're just trying to build up their curiosity. You're trying to get their interest into the story before you actually talk about it. So then you go on to say, after suffering from a rare degenerative brain disorder, a man was unable to see and identify the numerical digits 2 to 9. If he was presented with a picture of the digit 8 and asked to illustrate what he saw, he drew a scrambled mess of spaghetti-like scribbles with no relation to the number. So here you are describing the experience of that person. Do you still know what the story is about? No, you don't. But you're giving an introduction, you're giving a feel of what happened. That feel is what works in your blogs, in your feature stories, in your popular science articles. Get people to feel something. And that is what is happening here. You're being made to stand in the shoes of this person and experience what he experienced. And that is what you should try to do in your feature stories, in your blogs. Okay. Now, after this, you go on to the actual crux, which is the nut graph. Okay. So how somebody with a particular brain degenerative disorder, they started to notice symptoms and they found that the brain worked in a specific manner. So then they go on to explaining it. They start giving the background, and then it's a little long. I'm not going to make you read, or I'm not going to read out the whole thing, but they go into the details, but in a little informal manner. Here's where it gets really strange. By studying the RFS brainwaves with electroencephalography, the researchers revealed that he was processing visual information that he was not aware of. So they are trying to build the whole thing up as an experience, which you will also feel when you are reading. And you have these connectors, like here is where it gets really strange. All of this has deeply intriguing implications. So, you know, you are going to give a little bit of your own opinion into your soft news stories. You're trying to make it colorful. You're going to make it descriptive. This is something you have to avoid in your hard news stories and your press releases. Press releases for sure. Please do not use any descriptive language or something which is very flowery in your press releases. Never. Do it in your blogs. Do it in your soft news, popular articles. That is fine. Okay. Now, I'll just show you some leads or hooks which different types which have been used. Okay. Now here, for a story on how the bacterial strains rather than the species play a role in modeling the our gut microbiome, that was the main story. But look at the lead. Every day, the billions of bacteria that inhabit your digestive system change. The food you eat, medications you take, and germs you're exposed to make some bacteria flourish more than others. Scientists know that this ever-shifting balance of gut microbes is linked to your health and disease, but have struggled to pin down what makes one microbial balance better than another. So here, they have given you a small descriptive kind of lead where they are describing what happens, what is the what is actually happening, usually happens, and then they have a take on what is wrong, what's the problem there. The problem is that scientists are still struggling, have been struggling to pin down what makes one microbial balance better than the other. So only then, later, will they talk about the actual crux of the story. So bacterial strains playing a role, they're not talking about it in the first paragraph, but they're trying to attract your attention to the main story. Okay? Now, this is the introduction of a story based on a study by National Institute of Nutrition. Okay, so the story was that 50% of the middle-income group urban children suffer from multiple micronutrient deficiency. But see how it starts. A single glass of milk or an egg a day may just not be enough for your young one. That is, if he or she has to be healthy in the full sense of the word. So this is something which will attract the eyes of the parents. Okay, if this is not enough, then what is? What's the problem? So then they will go on to read that 50% of the middle income group urban children have micronutrient deficiency and how it can be overcome. So the findings of the study are explained later, but this is the hook which makes people read it. Okay. So this is something where a conference has been reported. Okay, a conference on effects of radio frequency and from cellular networks. And this is what how they have started. It's great to have a base station or wireless repeater of your cellular provider close to where you work or live. Your mobile works that much better. So they are trying to make you feel the same thing what you have already been feeling. So there's a little bit of empathy used here to know how people usually think, and they have pinpointed on that. It's nice that you can receive all the local FM radio transmissions in your town loud and clear. But are you and your family paying a hidden cost? So they are first making you recognize your own feelings and then putting a doubt. Are you paying a hidden cost in your health for these facets of urban living? And is anybody trying to understand and mitigate these unseen risks? So then they go on to the next paragraph. See the connection here, how they have brought out the connection to the conference. Disturbing questions such as these were raised here last week by researchers at this international conference. So this is how they brought out the connection between the lead and the actual story, which is on the conference. Okay, and this is for children, actually. This is for young world. In young world, there was this intro. Indians travel, but India itself can't travel. Who heard of a traveling continent? So this kind of curiosity arousing questions, this is also a lead. So I have some exercises here. Maybe we will send it to you by Google form later for you. But before that, I'll just show you something in social media, how you can utilize social media before we wind up. It's almost time, so I'll do it quickly. When we go for science for young audiences, especially on social media, well, nowadays everybody's hooked to it. So going for animations, comic strips is a very good idea for reaching out to young audiences. No, you can't expect kids to read much of text. So visual impact is very important. In fact, even for adults, visual impact is extra important. So make sure that you can get a proper storyline, plot line into bringing in your young audiences interest, to make them interested. Okay, so this is a small example I've placed here on what is gravity. And they've shown an imaginary drawing of something which could be gravity and how it is bringing the apples down, what it's doing, It's stretching itself. It's going in between the earth and the moon and all that. So this is how you can get children interested, visually attract them. Now, these are stories I used to write for young Hans. I just put it here so that I could explain what my technique of writing was. What I did was that I used to write a story, a proper actual story about for children, putting in characters, putting in a small plot and all that. And I used to incorporate the science part as well into it, you know, some little bit. Again, we are not going for very complicated science when we go to children. We have to take a single concept at a single time. So for each of my stories, I had a particular concept which I used to incorporate into the story. So by the time they read the entire story, they also know the science behind it. So this part, the Emo's yoga class, was a story about how different animals are coming together to find a swindler. And how, what was the crux of the story is whether animals forget. With what do they have memory issues like we humans do? That was what I wanted to highlight. That was the science part, which I again put as a blurb here on the right. You can see there is a small blurb. Do animals forget? Yes, they do. And there's the actual science fact is detailed again so that there is no confusion. So this is one technique which I have used. Now, if we look at animated videos, okay, there are a number of animated videos. I could show you one or two of them. We'll come to that. I'll first get you to listen to a small podcast. Can you hear the podcast? Can you hear it playing?
CSIR, CFTRI ki.
Yes.
Digest. Thali Tales mein aapka swagat hai. थाली टेल्स आपको पोषण, खाद्य अनुसंधान, स्वच्छता एवं खाद्य सुरक्षा संबंधी उपयोगी जानकारी प्रदान करता है। तो लीजिए प्रस्तुत है भाग एक, अंक आठ, 14 जून 2019। इस अंक में हम आपके लिए लेकर आए हैं कोको और चॉकलेट। एक मीठी सी कहानी चॉकलेट की, मीठी मीठी लालसा का रहस्य और विज्ञान चॉकलेट की रेशमी कोमलता का। तो लीजिए प्रस्तुत है मिठास से भरा ये अंक। कोको और चॉकलेट। आप यकीन करेंगे 99% लोगों को चॉकलेट पसंद ही होती है और बाकी का 1% मजाक ही कर रहे हैं। चाहे किसी से भी पूछ लीजिए कि उनकी पसंदीदा मिठाई कौन सी है, आपको उत्तर चॉकलेट ही मिलेगा। हैरानी की बात तो ये है कि ना जाने कैसे ये कड़वा और विचित्र स्वादयुक्त पेय इतना लोकप्रिय हो गया। विश्व भर में लोगों को चॉकलेट इतनी पसंद है कि लोग किसी अन्य मिठाई के मुकाबले इसी का सेवन सबसे अधिक करते हैं। आखिर लोगों को चॉकलेट इतनी पसंद क्यों है? शायद इसका कारण ये है कि चॉकलेट मुंह में आते ही पिघल जाती है, जबकि साधारण तापमान में वह ठोस रहती है। चॉकलेट के इस गुण का श्रेय जाता है उसमें मौजूद कोको बटर को, जो कि एक प्रकार का फैट या वसा है। ये 25 डिग्री सेल्सियस से कम तापमान में ठोस रहती है और वहीं दूसरी तरफ शारीरिक तापमान यानी लगभग 35 डिग्री सेल्सियस में पिघल जाती है। इससे शक्कर और कोको बटर पिघल कर हमें इतने अच्छे स्वाद का अनुभव देते हैं और यही कारण है इसकी लोकप्रियता का। चॉकलेट की सबसे प्रमुख सामग्री है कोको और कोको के बिना चॉकलेट का कोई अस्तित्व नहीं।
सो दिस वाज थाली टेल्स। इट्स अ पॉडकास्ट बाय सीएफटीआरआई बेंगलोर and they have this weekly podcast. So a podcast is similar to the radio, except that here you're using the internet instead of your
Coco darasal coco paper.
Yeah, sorry, can you still see the screen, the ppt?
No ma'am.
No, okay, no. I will share it again. So why I brought up podcast is, now, when we were talking about children, about young audiences. Now, just like how visually appealing it is for young audiences, even audios can help them, audios and videos can help them understand. But this is also an effective medium for farmers, for even students, because even they do not have the access to a lot of other social media. Like, we cannot expect farmers to be on Facebook or Instagram, but they definitely would be ready to listen to something similar to the radio. And if it is a podcast and if they are introduced to it at some point, they will definitely pick it up. So there are always, remember, even in farmers, there are progressive farmers who can act as, you know, leaders for the rest of the farmers. Remember that farmers are people who trust other farmers. They will not trust us who are trying to tell them something new. They will trust other farmers who are telling them something new. So when you use social media for, especially for the farming community, you have to pick up those people who can act as change leaders or opinion leaders, who can shape the opinions of other people, of the other farmers. And for that, you have to introduce them to such things, such as the podcasts. And when you introduce them to such things, they will spread it out. The same thing for WhatsApp. Now, WhatsApp is a major sharing platform for sharing information, because such things like podcasts, and they are supposed to be free. They are downloadable. So they can be shared easily on WhatsApp. And that is something which definitely farmers can use and will use. And that is something you have to promote also if you are promoting science communication among farmers. Now, I'll just go back to sharing some other blogs, which I think I can show you, where we use multimedia. Okay, I hope you can see the screen. Yes?
Yes.
So this is a blog, okay, which talks of climate change. You can see this is on the website, and you can see there is a video, a graphic, which is causing movement on the screen. Now, this is an important part of your science communication, layout and design. So if you can incorporate these facets of multimedia in your communication, nothing like it. So here you can see they have a moving video which kind of attracts your attention when you access the page, and then it goes on to start the blog. Now, remember, because it's online, blogs can be lengthy. And in fact, if you want to have an impact on, you know, a higher level of people, like, I'm not talking about the farming community here, but you want to reach out to the common people, but those who are urban and who read a lot, then this is a very effective method. So here they have used videos, they have used images along with text, along with quotes. They have used infographics. You can see this. There is an infographic here. They're showing a picture of 2000, of the year 2000, a glacier melts in West Greenland. Okay, because they're talking about climate change. And then as you move down, this is slowly changing to 2004. And you go down again, it's 2008. So they are using things like time-lapse images. Okay. And there is a technique called parallax scrolling in websites, which you can use for your blog. So this is something like that. This is parallax scrolling. So when you are scrolling down, you can't see the page moving, but the images are changing. The images are moving. Okay. So this is a technique. This is the latest techniques which are being used for communication. Okay. And now when that part is done, they have shown you a time lapse of so many years, and now you go down again, it's a text again, you have some images, and finally some data which is presented in the form of statistics. some more pictures, and then you have a video incorporated. You have a YouTube video embedded here for additional information. And again, some data projections. Okay, so this is one. I will show you one more where you also have interactivity. Okay, the other one was also interactive, but here you can see this is another one, Mission to the Sun. Okay, here you will see the text is less, the actual content is less, but it is impactful. How is it being made impactful? Through the background videos and images. Okay, there are moving images, and the information itself is just the crux, but it is going to make an impact. If you can have blogs like this, you are definitely going to have a huge impact, and it will get shared. It can go viral. This is the kind of writing communication we should be looking at here in India. We still don't have science writers like this or organizations which focus on science communication like this. This is more in the West that we find such beautiful presentations, but we can definitely work towards such things here as well. And you have again some text and images and quotes, and here you have something which is a little more interactive. Again, the temperatures are being shown in the form of an infographic. Okay, and then you have more of images and all that. Illustrations, using illustrations are also there. And there is one more here. This is again interactive. If you move your cursor, then these move as well. If not, no. So if you do this, is using interactivity to engage audiences is also very important in your science communication, especially if you're using social media or the internet. And you have a lot of flexibility with this medium, and this is why you should be using it. Okay. So this is just some few examples of blogs that I wanted to show you. As this is the what is
your committee, sir.
Did someone say something?
Sir.
Okay. So apart from this, yes, there are YouTube channels, YouTube videos. I wanted to show you the videos as well, but I don't think we have enough time. So maybe in a next workshop or something like that. And when it comes to, I just wanted to also say some more points about communicating with farmers. That was about how farmers have a certain value system. Now, when we communicate with farmers, we assume that they don't know anything, and we tend to dumb down the information thinking that they don't know, they're illiterate, and we have to tell them everything from scratch. No, they already have a lot of conventional wisdom, and we need to use that as a base to establish a common point. And then from there, you can start winning their trust and show them a new concept step by step. And that is the only way you can win them over, because changing attitudes is very difficult. And especially in the farming community, they are stuck with their conventional wisdom, which also has some value, not that it doesn't. Don't discredit that conventional wisdom completely, but use it as the base to communicate with them, and then move them on to more progressive ways of farming, of agriculture, of technology. And that is where you need to start from. And when you are thinking of media to communicate with farmers, like I said, you can use podcasts, you can use WhatsApp. WhatsApp videos are very effective, because these get viral, they get shared very quickly, and nowadays everybody has WhatsApp. And even in these rural communities, even if a single person has it, okay, even if a single person has a smartphone, because the community is close-knit, they will ensure that they call people to see. They'll all come together to see what is happening in that phone, what is happening in this video. So that makes a great impact. We may not realize it, but it can happen. And apart from that, using posters, I will just show you the examples of some posters here. If you look at this poster, okay, I know the text is in English, but you have to use the regional language, use more of regional language, local languages when you're using posters, and of course, more of visuals, because visual impact is of course great. That makes a much better impact. And then use success stories of local people. So when you are trying to communicate for scientists, for farmers, if you have your own newsletter, you have your own popular science magazine, use this as a medium to highlight the local experiences and show it to these farmers. They need to know that they have come, they have appeared in their particular article, their name has come in that particular article that you have written. And then they will be more forthcoming to participate in understanding and promoting science. So when you're doing your science communication, use those success stories to communicate to them and to communicate about them both. And ensure that you take account of the cultural values when you are communicating with them. Do not put in something very harsh, which can completely change their cultural value system. And when it comes to sharing information on Instagram, Facebook for the general public, okay, use hashtags, tag people, important people in the science field, public personalities who have a good following. See, this is an example of a post on Instagram. So they have used a lot of hashtags because hashtags help you to go viral. It helps people to search for something and they can find your post easily. So when you put a hashtag, you make yourself discoverable. Okay. And this is something in This Week in Science by the Science Nature page. They put up all the important stuff which has happened in the last week in very small paragraphs to show that what is the major news of the week. And this they share every week on their Facebook handle, Twitter handle. So remember, in Twitter you have to limit everything to a single to 280 characters, but there is no limit on the pictures you can share. So if you can fashion some posters like this where you can put in both images and information, this can get shared widely, okay, and it will have a lot of impact. And you can also, like I said earlier, be current, be in line with what is happening currently. So this is NASA Earth. What they did is they put out images, beautiful images of the galaxy, of space, with a connection to Halloween, okay, because this was at the time of Halloween. Gulls and goblins gather around, creatures take a seat, let's prepare for a quite chilling game of trick earth treat. So they did a play of words, used some puns, and they came out with these beautiful images which were in connection to the theme. And use contests and interactive posts to increase engagement. Ensure that people get a chance to have a dialogue, to post their own views. National Geographic gave a chance for people to post pictures of what they have shot. So that kind of thing is what you need to do when you are using social media. And mainly, your main information should be on your website or your blog. Your social media is only going to be the link where you can reach out to a large number of people and redirect them back to your website. Okay, so I think I will stop it here. I think I've taken the entire time. So Dr. Sridhar.
Yes ma'am, it's a very lengthy, long and very informative, and sitting in a classroom and hearing to my teacher. So I'm brushing up my UG days and then how the science communication. Definitely, I think all the attendees might have got enlightened, and probably we can see some new changes in there when they go back and say to their newsletter editors that we should go into these formats, all these things. Before that I'll stop here. I think we can hear, I would like to hear, request the director IHR, Dr. BNS Murthy, sir, to give his remarks, sir.
Can we give one or two questions? We can go back. There are some questions, actually.
Yes, sir.
If Madam agrees.
Yes, of course, sir. Yeah. I think there's a question on how to write a popular article in a more effective way by Amrita Lakshmi. Amrita, so this is what I was talking about, popular articles, soft news, feature stories. What you need to do is use more analogies. Okay, you have to find a connection between what the audience already knows. okay, and something which will interest them. It could be anything. It could be music. It could be popular culture. You can even give references to Bollywood movies if you want. If because it's a popular article, you can, you need to know the pulse of the people and then try to connect it to them. And then you have to bring your topic into focus. So that should be in your, especially in your introduction, in your delayed lead, you can utilize this. Apart from that, use humor, use illustrations, and that is how you can build your article. Now, actually, I wanted to give some exercise, but I think we don't have enough time. But in a more, you know, longer workshop, you need to actually sit and write. You will understand where you can enhance your writing.
Okay. Yes. Anyone sharp questions to the point?
Okay, Mr. Gopichand, what are the major precautions we have to take with regard to plagiarism when we communicate our research results? Okay, so if we talk about plagiarism, see, the first thing is there is no way you can stop people from copying your own stuff. Like if you have written something, there is every chance that somebody else can copy and paste it. The only thing you can do is ensure that you take a plagiarism report the day you publish your article and keep it ready so that anytime anyone asks, you can say on this date that it was published, my article was 100% clear. Now, if you want to talk about how to avoid plagiarism from other sources, when you're presenting your research results or when you're presenting their research results, sorry, when you're presenting others' research, you have to paraphrase. Paraphrasing is the main thing. Okay. And like I said, when you try to focus on the crux of what is happening, see, you are not going to say verbatim exactly what they have said, but you need to understand what they're saying first and then put it in your own words. That's the best way to avoid plagiarism. And whatever you cannot avoid, you need to put in quotes. And that's how you can avoid plagiarism. Attribution is important. Just attribute. If you think you cannot avoid taking something as it is, attribute it to the source wherever you have taken it from, and then you can rephrase it in your own words as well.
Okay, that was a very interesting, and there is no end for some of these questions. I believe it's a very elaborative. Sridhar, can I go ahead?
Sir, please.
Yeah. First of all, I thank both the resource persons, although I was not able to hear Dinesh Sharma, but I understand that he has also made us very, very important points. And about Sneha Varghese, it was mind-blowing. Just, in fact, I was throughout listening. That's why I asked you to go ahead before making my presentation.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah. Your talk was so impressive that you have any tips for the director's remarks?
I don't think I would dare to do that, sir. Of course,
no, it is not that.
So much from all of you. So
it is not like that, because there is an organization called, I am not commenting any organization, there is Art of Living. People from 80 plus also go for Art of Living classes now. Having led 80 years of life, they want to still learn. That kind of situation that has arrived because of these days.
Yes.
And I don't want to hold many of you between lunch and this particular topic, or going back to writing some blogs or popular articles or scientific communication or research papers that you are working on. But a couple of points I wanted to make. First thing, we have to know who is your client. Whether it is a, she actually started with, we should communicate with the children so that we get back a lot of inputs from them. They're with a pure mind. But when it comes to agriculture scientists, we need to know the farmers, who are they? And mostly we have to understand their education status. And many a times, any communication that we see, we have to play with the psychology of the person. That's what major point I want to make up on here. And again, who is your client? Again, other parties. Who is communicating? That's also very important. Having heard Sneha today, if she is going to make a presentation in some other forum, I would like to go back and hear to her. That kind of situation, one has to have it. That is who is communicating. And leaders in their own area, the people will follow. That's what I wanted to say. The scientific communication is one part. Science leads to communication, and this particular communication leads to the public awareness. That's what I see. That is a transition from public awareness from the science technologies. That is what is required. Most of the time, the precautions that we have to take is, many a times we use the phrase, you know, you know, you know. If your other person on the other side of your talk, he knows why he want to listen to you. That many a times it, without saying it comes, that we have to see. And we have about 26 alphabets, some punctuation marks. We have to play within that one. So many times what happens is many jargons we create and lead to confusion. Especially in scientific communication, this is very, very important, especially the subject you are coming from, biotechnology. Always there is abbreviations. And we actually get lost in the abbreviations before understanding any of the topics. And alphabets lead to phrases, phrases lead to sentences, sentence to paragraph, how to make the paragraph, where to end, where to stop. Paragraph make chapters. There again, chapters, what are they? Then the volumes. That kind of thing goes on in scientific presentation and the books. And in many of the scientific communications, as a scientist, I want to see that the proper units of measurements has to be used. Proper scientific measurement. There are different, this one, the SI system and the PDF system and other things. Proper has to be used according to the requirement. And in many of our communications, especially pictorial communication graphs, we don't describe the axis. We don't describe the units. Without that, we lose a lot of information. And the type of graphs that we use is very important. These days, many presentation tools that has a lot of different ways of pictography presentations. And we have to use a proper pictorial graph. A simple thing is a bar diagram versus a timeline series. Bar diagram is mostly used for individual units. Timeline is for a series, for timeline series. That kind of information one should see. For the tips for the many of people, scientists, you involve the students in your studies, involve the students. Whatever the papers that comes for review, make available for them and ask them, if you were to write this particular article, what changes you will bring in? This will actually some of the exercises that can be given in form for students so that they can learn a lot. And you made a lot of importance of the posters, how it has to be. Don't put a lot of information. There are certain things that can be observed. And all these days, there used to be a one-to-one or the physical presence of the person who is communicating. Now we have gone online. And most of the times we speak about the slide presentation. Before the next slide is flashed, talk a few words about that particular slide that is going to come. That shows your compatibility, capability, and also you can take the audience together. And I don't want to take much of time, especially when it comes to writing thesis or research articles, the background, the introduction, the abstract, and the conclusion, they should perform their own work. That's why when it comes to conclusion, you see what is the outcome of your work, what should have been done in future, that kind of information that should come. And most important in many of our press releases and other things, the important point is disclaimers. That is one thing, because many of our institutions, we have our own limitations. The disclaimers is another important thing. And to give a thoughtful thing for any reader, read in between the lines. That should come. These are my few points for today's workshop. It was a wonderful workshop. I thank the organizers, especially Sridhar Gautam and his team, Atikula, for taking it forward, Venkat Kumar, and also Dr. Dhananjaya, who is a sponsor of this particular program from SPHI. Thank you very much.
Sir, thank you very much, sir. Summing up the whole workshop and then giving the valuable tips for further for us to improve on in the scientific activities. Now we'll at the end, flag end, it's delayed a little more. But I think it's worthwhile waiting, skipping the lunch and then attending this program. Now, may I request Atikulla to propose the vote of thanks?
Thank you, sir. Before that, can we take one or two questions from audience if anybody wants to speak? Anybody wants to speak, just raise your hands, please. If not, I'll assume your purpose is served. I hope the purpose of today's session, the science communication, was meaningful, helped all who have been attended. I especially want to thank our beloved director, Dr. Vinesh Modi, sir, who has readily accepted our proposal, who has been through almost all the session after 10:30, and he had made very apt points, very aptly you told, sir. The psychology or the empathy of the receivers should tune up with the speaker. Then only the message percolates deeper and happens in meaningful communication. We made a quick note of points what you told, sir. It was very helpful. Thank you so much for joining the program in spite of your busy schedule. Thank you, sir. I am grateful to the two speakers of today's session, Dr. Dinesh Sharma, sir, and Ms. Neha Varghese. You have been running a big marathon show. Almost we were having a participants oscillating, but one or two only left, joined, rejoined happened. Almost all were sticking to the screens. They have taken much of the message content, and I hope they would want to ask you more. So I request you to kindly drop your email ID so that they can contact if you need anything. On behalf of ICR-IIHR, Society for Promotion of Horticulture, Division of Social Sciences and Training, we thank you so much, Dr. Dinesh sir and Ms. Sneha Vagis. I can't request to clap, at least clap yourself and the desk over there. I also thank Dr. Dhananjaya sir, Secretary SPH, and I also thank Dr. R. Venkat Kumar sir, Head of the Division of Social Sciences, who have been very supportive and encouraging in organizing this program. I especially thank, you know, any organization of any program, it takes much of background work. The whole person behind this was our Dr. Sridhar Gutam sir, senior scientist at IIHR. On behalf of all of you, I thank you, Sridhar sir, for taking all painstaking efforts and making this a grand success. Thank you so much, sir. Not but the least, all the participants, I could see a lot of my teachers are there, my colleagues, senior colleagues, friends, all joined from different SAUs, ICR institutes throughout the India. I could see a few foreign participants also. Many have joined and made this a program a very successful and meaningful. Once again, I thank all of you for making this event a possible one. Thank you so much, one and all. Chitra, anything to say or shall we leave the meeting?
Yeah, only one quick thing feed means I need to announce it. Like as Neha was saying, some of the exercises will be following it up with you. You have to give it back within a stipulated time in the Google form. Then and a feedback link also will be shared with you. So you can just wait for a few days. You will be getting those things in your email box. All those who have not registered, they please register so that we can capture the emails and then communicate all those resources with you for your use. So I think we can end the meeting and we can leave. Happy lunch. Thank you, Sneha, for being for this program. Thank you all. Thank you, everyone. Sir. Thank you, Dr.
Thank you, Dr. Modi, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you all.